Amen. Well, welcome to week number three of our series we're calling Summer Psalms. Everyone say Summer Psalms. But don't say it five times real fast. That will get difficult very quickly. And so each week, what we're doing is we're taking a look at a psalm or two. And this series has been so rich. I appreciate what was said and shared last week. That was a great message. And today is Father's Day. And some of you may have been wondering, you know, I'm just going to sit through a day when Pastor's going to talk to dads. Well, you know what? I'm going to talk to all of you today. Because the Bible always speaks to all of us. Here, never forget this. Even if you think the topic isn't for you, God has something in that for you. And if you'll just tap in and you'll listen, you'll get something out of it. So today we're going to look at a couple of psalms, I think, that have something for all of us. So go in your Bibles to Psalms 111 and 112. Psalm 111 and 112. These two psalms are most likely written together, and they're written in the form of an acrostic. So the beginning of every line in your Bible, the reason it's laid out the way it is it goes from, in the English, A to Z, but from Hebrew, I don't even know if it's right, Alpha to Omega, whatever the first, it's not, right? Y'all know a little Hebrew. So it's not, so it's something else, but it's acrostic, okay? Y'all got that? And I want you to take a moment, and I want you to look at this symbol on the screen. What does that symbol mean? Greater than, right? Greater than. What does this next symbol mean? Less than. That's right. So y'all got through third grade math. Okay. Or algebra or whatever. I don't know what it was. So that's a good thing. But you know what? The problem is oftentimes we look through life or look at life through these two symbols. Greater than or less than, right? And many of us, you know, we'd like to have a great life. How many of you like to have a great life? You know, just a great life. That'd be good. Well, what is a great life? Well, it's probably some different things to different folks, but probably most of us would include some combination of health. We'd include family in there. We'd include finances, you know, and you'd probably say, if I have to work, I'd like to have something that I enjoy, you know, if I'm not independently wealthy and just do whatever I want, at least I enjoy my work, right? And I think this is where we miss it many times, is we live in a world where we can see what everybody else is doing. Not everybody, but a lot of people. And you can see those that you think are living greater than you, and you can feel discouraged, and you can feel like, well, they got a great life, and here I am digging ditches today in my job. Or you can look at somebody else and say, well, I'm not doing that, and you get all full of pride. You know, I'm greater than. I'm greater than where they are. And I think we miss it. And I think our standard is wrong. We often miss it. And so today I want you to see that a great life is determined more by what happens in us than what happens to us or around us. Amen. It's what happens on the inside of us. And so these two psalms, I think, clearly point us to a great life. So we're going to unpack them. And if you're going to talk about a great life, I think the benchmark of a great life is it begins with God. Amen. It begins with God. So let's take a look at God's great works from Psalm 111. That's what this chapter is all about. When we see how great God's works are, and realize how wonderful his works are, not only in our lives, but in all of creation, the first thing it should do is it should produce praise. It should produce praise in our lives. Verse 1, praise the Lord. I will thank the Lord with all my heart as I meet with his godly people. Notice here, it says, I will. You ever gotten a service or got up one morning and just like, I'm not feeling it today. It's just not there for me. What happens is you miss out on an opportunity to praise God. We think it's for us, but it's not for us. It's for him. The fringe benefit, the byproduct is it blesses us when we praise him, right? And so our praise of God should not be contingent on the quality of our life, but on the greatness of our God. Amen. Let me say that again so y'all need to write that down. Our praise of God should not be contingent on the quality of our life, but in the greatness of our God. Amen. He's great. You having a bad day? God's still great. You wake up not feeling it? He's still a great God doing great works, right? And so I think a great life begins with these expressions of gratitude to God. Amen? Amen. And because when we begin to praise him, the more and more gratitude rises up in us, and really the better life seems. Because we've got this attitude of gratitude. Notice that the psalmist's intent here is to express that gratitude in the presence of other godly people. That's important to notice in this chapter. There's something about praising and worshiping God with others. I just love to be in the building. I love to be here together. And I'm not against you that are online, but man, there's just something about being in the building together. And you just get to experience God together. It's a wonderful thing. And so we just see God working in people all the time. Amen? So God's great works should produce praise. Here's the second thing. They should be pondered. Have you ever pondered? What do you ponder? Let's look at verse 2. How amazing are the deeds of the Lord. All who delight in them should. See, you don't have to be creative to be a speaker or to preach. You just have to read the Bible. Look at that. Here's that point. Should ponder them. Right? Amen. Verse 3. Everything he does reveals his glory and his majesty. His righteousness never fails. He causes us to remember his wonderful works. How gracious and merciful is our Lord. What have you been pondering lately? What are you mulling over? What are you kicking around? What have you been thinking on? You know, we ponder our future. We ponder decisions. A lot of us get stuck pondering our past. We spend more time thinking about what's already happened to us than where we're going and what God can do in us and through us. And we wonder why we're discouraged. You got to watch what you ponder. By the way, anytime that you see your emotions are not where they need to be, just go back and rewind about 5 minutes and see what you've been pondering. You'll know why you are where you are emotionally in that moment. So the example the psalmist lays out here is to ponder, to think on, intentionally think on God's great works. I mean, the psalmist here isn't just writing these so, well, let's see, in about 3,000 years, there's going to be some people sitting in Spring, Texas to read. He wasn't thinking that. He was pondering. He was journaling, if you will. He was writing this out. Amen? Begin to ponder how God's worked in your life. That's a good thing to ponder. What he's brought you through. Amen. Well, here's a good one. Ponder the times you were desperate. Yeah. And God showed up.
Amen. That's good.
God showed up. I mean, I don't have time to go there, but you remember when the children of Israel went from the wilderness into the promised land and they crossed the Jordan. And once again, God divided the water there and they walked over on dry land. One of the things that they did there is they took some rocks and they built a memorial. Amen. In your life, you may not have the rocks, but you can ponder. You can memorialize, you can remember what God's done in your life. Ponder how gracious he's been to you. Amen. Ponder his mercy in your life. How many times you know there's something that should have happened because of what you did and it didn't. That's God being merciful to you. You didn't get away from it or get away with it. God was merciful to you. That's what happened right there. Amen. And you know, most of us, when we receive something incredible from the Lord and we notice his great works, we're just kind of quick to move on. We have this kind of next. You know, we forget what God did yesterday and we just, well, what are you going to do today? What are you going to do today? And we got God on a performance kind of scale here. And we're just waiting for him to show up. Look at first part of verse 5. He gives us more to ponder. He gives food to those who fear him. Now ponder this. Not only that he provides, but notice when he provides. He provides when we revere him, when we fear him. Years ago, I heard a pastor just talking to other pastors, and he was talking about finances in his own personal life and even finances in the church. And he said, whenever finances got tight, and some of you have been pondering a lot about your finances, He said, whenever finances get tight, the first thing he did was look for waste. Because he noticed that God would not bless him when there was waste.
Amen.
Amen? That was the first thing. So he would think about, did I give God the first of all of my income? Amen. Did I put him first in that? Maybe he would look. Maybe there was some recurring bill. I think he told about a dumpster one time they had in the church property, and he forgot they had that dumpster and they didn't need it anymore. And they were paying that fee every single month, and it was over there. And to find it, he thought about that. God took care of that. See, God's a stewardship God. He wants us to handle what he gives us well. Amen. So why do I share that? Because one of the ways that we revere, that we show respect to the Lord, even the fear of the Lord, is that we treat what he entrusts to us with respect. We handle it well. Amen? That we handle what he gives us how he wants it handled. We think it's all for us, but it's not all for us. He's given it to us for a purpose. So if you ever face lack, ask yourself this question. Am I showing proper respect to God by how I treat what he gives me? Am I respecting that right? Just ask him and then listen. Amen. I promise you, he'll show you adjustments. He'll show you where to lurk. Look, and I've used this same principle over the years at the church, and it's just amazing. It's just, you find things and you just kind of out of sight, out of mind, and just beyond that. And what's going to happen is you'll see his provision begin to open up again. Why is that true? Look at the rest of verse 5. He always remembers his covenant.
Amen.
How often?
Always.
There's never a time he doesn't remember his covenant. There's never a time he won't come through. For his covenant's not a word we use, but it's way more than a promise. It means I'm all in. I'm all in. I'm in this. Verse 6, he has shown his great power to his people by giving them the lands of other nations.
Amen.
So are you living in the fear of the Lord? Waiting for a breakthrough? Then ponder the idea that God keeps covenant. He keeps covenant. He promised his people to give them the promised land, and he delivered.
Amen.
He kept his covenant. Amen. And so one of the things that I appreciate just in this whole idea of pondering is I appreciate about Kay is that Kay ponders, Kim's mom. She'll be thinking on things that God said or done, and she'll remind Kim and I often, and I'm a little bit more of a next guy. You know, now, okay, yeah, good. Okay, but what's next? But she's always good. That's one thing that she's really good at. So just grow in your ability to ponder what God's done, what he's doing. Here's a good one. Faith, pondering what he's going to do based on his word. Amen. And we just need more of that trait in our life. We're so hurry. We're so rushed. We can't take downtime, because the first time we get a moment of downtime, what do? We pick up the phone. Flick on the TV. We're looking at something. Turn it all off. Just turn it all off.
Amen.
Ponder. Amen. Ponder God's great works in our lives. Amen?
Amen.
God's great works should also do something else. They should be clear to us. They should be clear. Look at verse 7. All he does is just and good. All he does. And all his commandments are trustworthy. They are forever true, to be obeyed faithfully and with integrity. Have you ever heard or seen something and you think, that doesn't sound like them?
Yes.
I don't know if they would have said that. I mean, I know you're saying that, but I think I know them. See, God does no shady works.
Amen.
We can be clear when we think about the great works of God. They're going to be just. They're going to be righteous. They're going to be trustworthy. They're always good. His commandments can always be trusted. They are forever true. Amen?
Amen?
God's commands don't get old. They don't get outdated. They don't even go out of style. They don't. Hey, now, society may think they have. Society may say, well, they're not true anymore, but But because God's commands are trustworthy, they're timeless.
Amen.
They become timeless because they can be trusted by the very nature of them. Amen? Yes. Anybody remember wood paneling?
Yes.
Not timeless. VCRs. I'll go back a little bit for some of you before my time. 8 tracks.
Yeah.
8 tracks. 8 tracks, right? VCR tapes with music on them, right? Yeah, nothing lasts. They were not timeless, but God's commands are. They are forever true, regardless of how we feel, regardless of how it looks, regardless of what everyone else thinks. They are right. Amen? And because they are true, we can obey them faithfully. They're just worth it. Amen? That's going to work out. Here's another thing God's great work should be. They should result in awe. There should be awe. Verse 9. He has paid a full ransom for his people. Isn't that awesome? He bought us by his blood. He has guaranteed his covenant with them forever. Forever. Did you notice that? What a holy, awe-inspiring name he has. Isn't it good that God through Jesus ransomed us? He bought us back, put us into covenant with himself. That covenant is unbreakable. Even if you had a bad day yesterday, said something you shouldn't have on the way to church today, covenant is unbreakable.
Amen.
If you bought in, he's all tied into you. Amen? So our response to God's great works is we should grow in wisdom a little bit. Now, what strikes me about this psalm is that the psalmist, I really think, as he was going through this, he was awestruck. It says here, what an awe-inspiring name he has. He was awestruck. He was in awe of how great God's works were, how incredible they were. When was the last time you were in awe of God? When you just had that awe. Most of us, we've been through some stuff. Anybody been through some stuff? Yeah, we've been through some stuff. There's been times life has been hard. There's been maybe our life and our heart has gotten filled with hurts. Maybe we're trapped by regrets. Been through some stuff. And when we go through those seasons or get stuck in that season, we tend to lose our awe of God. We can wonder, is he still as great as he was in the good days? By the way, the answer to that is yes.
Amen.
Just sometimes our perspective is clouded. One of the blessings of being a parent, and you parents know this, is that it's a great opportunity to see the world through your child's eyes. There's something incredible. You know, children typically, young children, they're filled with wonder and anticipation. Just think about it for a moment. This will help you grab a hold of awe. Everything they've seen, they've never seen before. It's all new. Never seen it. And when we've seen it over and over, you ever seen those videos when now they're able to take some children and they can help restore their sight or their hearing? If you ever seen one of those videos, it'll just break your heart. They're just overwhelmed. That's awe. That's overload, sensory overload. And the same kind of perspective ought to be ours about God. See, here's the thing. How many of y'all are kind of people you want everything figured out? Where's my everything figured out people? And especially when it comes when it has to do with God.
Absolutely.
Man, if I just could figure out that, then I'd trust him more.
Oh, no.
No, you wouldn't. One of the things that allows us to remain in the awe of God is we don't have it all figured out. And so when you come to a place in your journey, in your faith, where you're like, man, I don't know. Ooh, God's amazing. Just get that sense of wonder, that sense of awe back. Amen? Now, the next verse is key between the transition between Psalm 111 and Psalm 112. And it's key to all the blessings that we're about to see about a great life in Psalms 112. And it's the last should be I'm going to give you today. God's great works should also produce the fear of the Lord.
Amen.
The fear of the Lord. Verse 10. Fear of the Lord is the foundation of true wisdom. In other words, you can't actually be wise unless you have the fear of the Lord. All who obey his commandments will grow in wisdom. Praise him forever.
Amen.
Now, here's the thing about the fear of the Lord. God don't play.
Amen.
He don't play. Oh, I am a friend of God. Well, you are, but he's still God.
Amen.
You belong to Jesus. You can be his friend. But have you ever experienced something or gone through something and you just had that inner, it just like took your breath away, like, ooh, this is holy. Like Moses, I'm standing on holy ground. I mean, I'm in this place of holiness, and you just begin to realize how much greater God is than you. That just begins to touch the fear of the Lord. I remember way back when I was a kid, remember I'm a southern boy from southern Minnesota who grew up on a farm. And I was helping my dad with the grain harvest. And driving a truck, and we had a grain auger. You may not know what it is, but a hopper our hopper was about this big, and it's like a inverted triangle, okay? And at the bottom was about a six, probably an 8-inch auger that turns like a drill bit, you know, that little. So it augers, it actually moves the grain from that hopper up into another place, into the bin or whatever you're sending it to. Well, I jumped up on the, and when you raise the back of the truck up, the corners would always have grain in them because the only opening was right there in the middle. And so you'd put one foot on the hopper, put the other foot up on the truck, lean over the truck with a shovel, and you'd shovel out of that corner into the middle, and then you'd go to the other side, and if you got too aggressive, you'd have to go back to the other side again until you got it all out of the truck, because Dad didn't want me coming back out to the field with a half full truck, right? Well, one day, I was up doing that, and I fell into the hopper. I fell into the hopper. Now, it wasn't, the other little trick about doing this whole thing by yourself was you never ran over the hopper. Because that was waste. Dad had probably killed for less. You didn't waste. You know, that was a big thing with him. So you learned how to manage that. And I fell in there. Well, you know, it might have been just a couple inches. A few inches below the grain was that auger. And we had neighbor kid. I knew a neighbor girl who lost legs in a farm accident and that kind of thing. So I was very aware of all that. But I fell in there. And I, all of a sudden, instantly was able to get out without sticking my hand into the auger, without getting a foot into the auger. And I remember when I got done with that, I shut it all down. I just needed a moment. And I don't know, my mom maybe was driving another tractor or something, helping Dad. He was harvesting, and Grandma was in the house. And I ran to the house and I said, Grandma, I just fell into the hopper. But I'm okay. And I just had this fear of the Lord moment. After she looked at me and she said, Doug, God has a purpose and God has a plan for your life. And at that moment, I realized that he was right there with me. And you've probably had those moments. And when you ponder, I want to encourage you to ponder some of those moments. I want you to think about when God showed up and you were like, oh, I'm gonna get this right because God don't play. I'm going to live in the fear of the Lord. There's another passage, not in Psalms, where we see this in the Bible too. It's in the book of Acts chapter 5. And let me just read it. It says, there was a certain man named Ananias who with his wife Sapphira sold his property. He brought part of the money to the apostles claiming it was the full amount. So what did he do? He lied. With his wife's consent, he kept the rest. Then Peter said, Ananias, why have you let Satan fill your heart? You lied to the Holy Spirit and you kept some of the money for yourself. The property was yours to sell or not sell as you wished. And after selling it, the money was also yours to give away. How could you do such a thing like this? You weren't lying to us, but to God. So somehow in our lives, what we think we can do many times as well, it's just people. It's not just people. It's God. How we treat others matters. They conspired together to lie to God. In this case, it happened to be about giving. And then during this season of the church, people were selling their property and saying, I'm just going to give it all because we're going to help those in need, because there was many people that needed help in that time. And so Ananias, he goes to give, but he lies about it being the full amount, and he drops dead. Skip down to verse 7. About 3 hours later, his wife came in. Why did his wife come in? Because she hadn't got a text from Ananias in about 3 hours. No, they didn't have text back then. Not knowing what had happened, Peter asked her, was this the price you and your husband received for your land? Yes, she said, that was the price. Peter said, how could the two of you even think of conspiring to test the Spirit of the Lord like this? The young men who buried your husband are outside the door and they'll carry you out too. Verse 10, instantly she fell to the floor and died. When the young men came in and saw that she was dead, they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. That's the setup for the verse I want you to see. Yeah. Verse 11, great fear gripped the entire church and everyone else who heard what had happened. You know, you only need about one of those a year. I mean, just think about it. They probably knew this family. They knew this couple. Right? They'd been in a small group together. They broke bread. They had communion together. They knew that. I mean, just think about it, man. If that can happen to them, what about me? What a sobering reminder. We have to be honest in our interactions with others and with God. And some of us think, well, I'm just a seasoned, God's going to let me get in the way with things. Be careful. When you have the fear of the Lord, you know he's watching. And you want to be right with him. So what's the result? You change. God says, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. I don't change. So when something's not right, it's us who need to change. Amen? So what they felt in that moment was the fear of the Lord, not just respect, not only awe, but a holy fear, a holy reverence for God, a holiness that resulted in a desire to live for the Lord and to please him. Amen. You know, many people, they claim they want revival. You see people posting, you see things, man, we're believing God for revival. You know the common trait to every revival in history? Always starts with the fear of the Lord. People just realize he's holy. You read the book of Acts. You know, verse 6, they're feeding a lot of people. Verse 7, Stephen and 8, Stephen gets stoned. 9, Jesus shows up to Paul. There's just thousands of people coming to faith in the Lord. It's happening with the fear of the Lord. Amen. The fear of the Lord. So let's make the decision to honor God, to live in the fear of the Lord, to treat God, treat his word, treat what he gives us, his spirit, his people, with honor, with integrity. And if we do that, then Psalm 112 is ours. Let's go there quickly. These are some great rewards for living for God. Verse 1. The first reward is joy. How many need more joy? Yeah, verse 1. Praise the Lord. How joyful are those who fear the Lord and delight in obeying his commands. Notice again that the fear of the Lord is key here. As I mentioned earlier, this psalm is also a poetic acrostic. So God's great from the first letter to the last letter of the alphabet. And also the rewards of the godly run, if we would say in English, from A to Z. Amen? So what's the difference between a day you're joyful and a day you're not? When you're joyful, significant changes seem smaller. The difference between a great day and a not so great day is joy. It changes your day. So what do the godly delight in? The godly delight in obeying God's commands. One of those commands is don't steal. A few days ago, I was at Lowe's. I was going to pick up some things I needed. How many are trying to keep your grass alive? Yeah. All right. I don't have a sprinkler system in one part, and I'm just trying to keep my grass alive. And so I went and got some things, and I checked out. And I was like, man, I'm short one thing. I said, well, I was debating whether I needed to get that or not. That's fine. No problem. I get to my car. Realized I had attached it. It was in another piece of what I bought. What would you do? I went back, took it in. It was inconvenient for me. It was a $1.98 part. It was insignificant for them. But doing it right matters. It's important. Amen. We're gonna obey God's command. Why do the godly have joy? Look at verse 2. Their children will be successful everywhere. An entire generation of godly people will be blessed. It says in the NIV, their children will be mighty in the land. Amen. I love that. Isn't that good? Amen. One of the things that will either cause you great joy or great heartbreak is your family, is your kids. Amen? How the kids are doing. So regardless of how your kids are doing today, this is a great verse to pray over them, and I would encourage you even to speak over them. And here's the thing. When they're going through a hard time, when they're not living like they need to be living, don't speak that over them. Speak what you want God to do in their life over them. Begin to pray these verses over them. Amen? And so just do that. Let them hear you say that. Believe God that they're going to be an influence in their generation. Verse 3. They themselves will be wealthy and their good deeds will last forever. In the Hebrew here, the word wealth doesn't mean, you know, filthy rich. It means enough. Amen. Enough to do what God's called you to do. Enough to be a blessing to others. Enough. Amen. And all of those good deeds, they're going to impact people for eternity. Amen. I love that. They're going to last forever. So not only will the godly experience joy, they will, here's the second thing, be unfazed by difficulty. Turn to somebody and say, unfazed by difficulty. Verse 4, light shines in the darkness for the godly. Think about that. Dark for everybody else, but for the godly, light shines in that darkness. They are generous and compassionate and righteous. Verse 5, good comes to those who lend money generously and conduct their lives or their business fairly. Verse 6, such people will not be overcome by evil. Those who are righteous will be long remembered. They do not fear bad news. Have you ever gone through a season where you started fearing bad news? Like, who else is going to call? What's going to happen now, right? They confidently trust the Lord to care for them. See, when we live a life that pleases God, we are different in difficulty. We're different in hard times. We expect God's light to shine in our dark time. We expect Him to show up. So that means we can still be generous. We can still be compassionate. We can still be righteous. Amen? Now, isn't that the opposite of what happens to most people when things get hard?
Yes.
When things get hard, most people become stingy, hard, and cut corners to make it. Totally the opposite of what God's called us to do as believers. And we're not overcome by evil. We're going to be remembered. For somebody here today, that's a really big phrase. You feel forgotten. I just sense this in my spirit. You feel forgotten. And the Lord says, just do it His way. You'll be remembered. And by the way, for the right things. For the right things. Amen? We're not overcome by evil. We'll be remembered. Why is all this even possible? Because the godly trust God to care for them. They're trusting Him. So what a contrast to society. They're all freaking out because things are getting bad. We're like, when's the light going to shine? When's God going to show up in the middle of this? When is He going to? Listen, God doesn't like to show out when everything's great. He likes to show up when everything's hard. Why? He wants the glory. Well, He's really proud. No, you be careful. When you're really the Lord, you can have it all. Amen. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. What a great life. What a blessing to live godly. Now, not only will the godly experience joy and be unfazed by difficulty, here's the third thing. They will be secure in God. I love this. Verse 8. Their hearts are secure. What's been going on in your heart? Y'all over the place? Moved by everything that's happening? They will have no fear. Why? Because when you have the fear of the Lord, you don't have fear in life. You know, you got it right. People who struggle and maybe are lacking, and there's times we all do this, where we don't really have the fear of the Lord right, then we start fearing life. But when we have the fear of the Lord, we're trusting God to show up. Amen? We're secure. They will look in triumph on their foes. I like that. Amen. They have freely scattered their gifts to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. Their horn will be lifted high in honor. Verse 10, the wicked will see and be vexed. Come on, let's go vex some wicked people today. Amen? Not because we're talking down to them or bad to them. We're just doing what God's called us to do. Amen? They will gnash their teeth. Waste away. The longings of the wicked will come to nothing. Everyone has longings. You got longings? For a better life? For a great life? The difference is the godly are not trusting themselves. They're trusting in whom? God. Sure, they work hard. Sure, they use their gifts and abilities for God. But they know their own ability and they know their results come from the Lord. So the question today is, do you want a great life? Everybody look at me. Do you want a great life? Do you want a great life? Life will never be without difficulties. It'll never be without challenges. In fact, I would encourage you this. Sometimes we take the most ground in life in the hardest times. Amen. Never think that just because it's hard, we're not going to do what God's called us to do, or we're not going to become more like Jesus, or we're not going to take ground. Some of the greatest ground you'll ever take is when it's hard, when you're working through. Amen. The dangerous times are when it's good. Yeah. Remember that. So our trust is in God and we're emotionally secure knowing what? We're in God's care. Doesn't matter what happens in the economy, we're in God's care. So let's pull this all together today. When we're in awe, when we're in wonder, when we're expecting God's ability to show up, we're expecting Him to do the great works we see throughout the scriptures. When we have the fear of the Lord on the inside of us, then we can live by His instructions, we can live by His rewards, and we can live godly. Amen? A godly life is a great life. Amen? I want us to all take this next step. For a great life, let the fear of God produce godly living. You'll have a great life. God will take care of it. You'll overcome the obstacles, but you'll see victory. Amen? Let's bow our heads this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we just come to you today. Lord, you know where we all are. Father, for some of us today, the word that spoke to us was the fear of the Lord. That phrase, we need more of that fear in our lives. And Father, I pray that it would not come through something traumatic or difficult, but that we would just be very intentional to honor you, to treat you with that healthy fear. Father, I thank you that you're working in every one of our lives, whatever it is today. Lord, I pray that you would help us to remember your great works, to ponder them, and to live for you and see your blessings in our lives. With every head bowed, every eye closed, you online, just pause briefly where you're at. And maybe you say, Pastor, I don't have a relationship with God. Maybe you prayed a prayer and you kind of just did a little thing to get by, kind of bought your fire insurance, you thought, so to speak, that you were just going to, you know, kind of try to get free of something and then, but not really live for God. And you're realizing right now you need to go all in. Stop playing games. This is real. This is life. And go all in with Jesus. If that's you today, I want you to be bold. I want you to take a step of faith. I want you to lift your hand and say, yes, I need to give my life to Jesus. I want to give my life to Jesus today. Lift your hand. Hold it up high. Hold it up unashamedly. I'm not going to call you down front. I'm not going to have you stand. I just want to see your hand. Show it to God. He's the one looking. He's the one looking. And pray this prayer with me today. You can put your hands down. Heavenly Father, I come to you today. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to make me a new person from the inside out. God, I turn away from my old ways. I turn away from my ways. And I turn to you. God, I believe you raised Jesus from the dead. And Jesus, I ask you, be my Lord. Lead my life. I surrender to you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, can we praise him this morning?